Welcome back. So to kind of round out our discussions, we're going to talk about patents. This is where a lot of technology falls under when you're actually making new things, you're innovating designs, you're creating new technologies. So let's take a look at what types of intellectual property processes are available to us here. Now, patents are a strategy, if you will. So what does it give us? It gives us the right to exclude others from practicing our invention. So if you think about it as an invention, something that's a new idea that you've actually fleshed out, you've created, you can prevent other people from using that invention. Now, you can only prevent it for a certain period of time, roughly 20 years, but it is protection. And it's something that many companies look for because it gives a whole bunch of value to the company. It gives you the right to practice. It may be limited by others' patents rights, so you have to be careful with that. Protection time, again, is about 20 years, but it's from the filing date granted by the government. So at this point, it changed. It used to be that it was the first to come up with the idea, and so people would have to have things in journals and stuff like that that they couldn't erase. It couldn't be in pencil. So we used to have to, anytime we did research or something, we'd have to keep everything written down in pen in all these journals that had no pages where you could insert anything, because that would be a common thing. People try to say, oh no, we came up with this idea back here. And really they didn't, they just tried to insert something. So in order to get rid of all that, at least in the United States, they started to get it to say it's the first to file, right? First to file for the application. Kind of like a real estate analogy, a patent kind of claims what your real estate of what you can use. So if you think about it like a fence around your property, it's like, this is my property. In here, I can play and do whatever I need to do for my business. Outside of this perimeter is your space or somebody else's space. So the ownership is limited to really what's inside of that and what you can do on the zoning and access rights. You also have the right to prevent other people from coming on your property and using your property or doing anything like that. So that's kind of an analogy from a law perspective of what it gives you. There are some challenges. Patent searches to look for prior art and existing patents has to be done. I encourage you to do a preliminary version. An easy way to do a preliminary version is if you use Google, but if you use it with Google Scholar, you can actually do searches across patents and you can filter for those types of things. It is not the end-all be-all. You will miss things. The reason you will miss things, and even if you go to the USPTO's office and do a search there, you can do that as well. And I suggest that's the next level to search. But you will miss things because you may not be completely familiar with all the different types of terminology that's used to describe what you're looking for. So something for you that you may think is a handle, so you're searching for everything that you can with the word handle, somebody else may be saying lever. And so something that is protected could be right next to yours and you wouldn't even know it. So that's why you want to do pretty exhaustive search on lots of variations of using different words and things like that. If you have the funding for it, you definitely want to have an attorney do a research, do an exhaustive search and give you a report on, okay, we found that there's space for you to play. That's really the best way to go about it, if you can afford all that. So full U.S. patent filing costs, that gets expensive. We'll talk a little bit more about that. International filing costs, again, even more expensive if you want to protect something worldwide versus just the United States. Some of the problems are issues. There's a whole discussion. I'm not going to go into that now, but you guys can go on your own time and take a look at that and look at some of the different problems and issues with having patents. So let's look at U.S. patent costs. So this was actually some information that I accessed last year. So the U.S. patent search and application costs vary depending upon the patent. If you're looking just for the prior art report where they're researching existing patents, doing it through Google Scholar, USPTO, and PCT, if you do it by yourself, it's free, obviously, because you can go through all that. it's a great start. It's a little bit high risk if you don't know what you're doing. So you want to make sure that you're, again, researching using a whole bunch of different words and different schemes. Particularly if you're going international, now you may have things in different languages, so you got to make sure that you have the right translations and things like that. So that's a great way to start, and I would do that before you even spend any money on doing a full professional search by an attorney, because that'll at least give you an idea if there's something obvious that's there that is so similar to what you're proposing or your design, then you might want to reconsider how to do your design, or maybe design around that design. So a professional search by an attorney can be anywhere between $1,000 to $3,000. And again, that doesn't solidify that you absolutely are going to get that patent. It just, they'll let you know kind of probability, say, yes, I think there is a possibility to patent in this space, or no, there's significant other patents that are already in this space that look like what you're proposing. That's kind of what you get out of it. Then the next level is provisional filing. So a provisional is really announcing that I am applying. However, it is not actually prosecuting a patent. It doesn't actually start going through the queue. It gives you a start date, right? It's like, I filed on this date. That's what it gives you. The advantage for startups is they have discounted fees. So they really try to entice, by policy, small companies, startups, to engage in this process, because it's much cheaper for you. So approximately $140 for small entities, plus drawings, which is roughly $100 to $125 per page. Now, if you have attorneys doing your provisionals, then it's gonna be $2,500 to $3,000to do that. Now, I've done the work up to provisionals. I've filed one myself. I've actually also used attorneys for it. If you have the money to do it, I'd recommend having an attorney help with that. But you'll find, particularly the more technically complex it is, they're really gonna need you to specify a lot of the components and how it works and things like that in those spaces, unless they're an attorney that specializes and has training in that technology space. So keep that in mind. The preparation of an application via an attorney, so if you're doing a full application, it could be anywhere as low as $5,000, $15,000. I've seen some quote up to like $22,000. So roughly though, if you're in that higher range, it better be pretty complex, because otherwise they're kind of taking you. So I would look for somebody who, if you can, is a little more cost effective than that, because you're paying by the hour, remember. The U.S. filing fee is somewhere between $400 to $800, depending upon the entity that you are. The full patent prosecution, again, $5,000 to $15,000 plus. This is when an attorney using or working on this. And again, complexity matters. So the more complex it is, the more types of things and the more claims you're trying to do, this could be a 2x multiplier, you know, up to $30,000, depending. So, and there's maintenance costs. This is where the true cost of patents comes in. It could be up to $100,000 for a life of a patent to keep it going. And that could be in a country. So that gets really expensive, particularly if you're going to go in multiple countries. So note that if you're a micro entity, which most startups are, the prices are half off. And medium to large companies, it could be twice as much, twice as expensive for some of these costs. So keep those things in mind. Now, if you want to go more worldwide and get foreign patent applications, there's a different set of costs and a different entity. So again, this is where you go through the World Intellectual Property Organization, or WIPO, and we actually utilize what's called the Patent Cooperation Treaty, or the PCT. So a PCT filing fee is about $1,000 to $4,000, and it's usually roughly $15 a sheet for anything that's over 30 sheets. So again, they kind of get you on, you know, how big is my document? So you got to think of that. That's also per country. Now, there's a big long list that the WIPO has where you can look at the price of every country. And so they're all a little bit unique. So you want to be really strategic as to which countries do you really want to go into business and want to protect, because you're going to be spending maintenance costs and money and application fees for all of those countries. So for all of Europe, because there's the Eurozone, you can have a European filing fee for about $6,000 to $8,000. Japanese filing fee is between $7,000 to $10,000, and so on. So there's some groupings that you can get there. The nice thing about the PCT is that it gives you about 18 months of time before you have to do the full filing for the first application. So, and a lot of people may do that first and then go back and file a full U.S. patent because it gives you some time to have some worldwide rights. Other people will do a preliminary application in the U.S., and then before that expires, you then file your PCT. So you get the 12 months from the U.S. filing, then you get another 18 months from the PCT filing before you do a full patent filing. And for startups, that could be critical because you're talking about management of money over that process and actually fundraising and getting funds into the company. International maintenance costs can be quite expensive. So for example, if you're getting 10 developed countries over the life of a patent, it can be anywhere between $300,000 to $500,000 just to keep those patents maintained. So before you can do anything with a patent though, you have to do what's called an invention disclosure. And that's the very first step. In an invention disclosure, the first thing you have to do is kind of create a strategy on how you're going to do this. When do you want to file? And oftentimes, because you're a startup or a company that's early, you got to time these things because you got to pay for them, right? What type of application are you going to do? You need to figure that out. Which one applies? And what's your scope of application? You got to have a review of prior art. Do a patent search. Again, use the Google Scholar. That's a great way to start, and then you go to like the USPTO office and the PCT. Public domain products, you can obviously look at those. Tech and trade publications, if you see anything there. Create a claim hierarchy outline. So this is where you identify unique components of your technology and the characteristics and subcomponents. So you actually, it's mapped out like a hierarchy and almost like an equation. They do a good job of describing that in the text. Then we have to write a description of our invention. It has to have a title, list of inventors, the field of invention, the background of the invention, brief description and drawings, and detailed description of the invention. This whole process, again, you can go through in the textbook. And in another class, I actually have an exercise where we go through all this process. You refine and write the claims. Now, I should state with this, if you're filing a provisional, you can file a provisional without writing your claims, which enables you to do it with or without an attorney if money is tight. Be careful though. What I don't recommend is trying to write your own claims if you've never done it before or have no experience in what that looks like and how to do it. That's where I would make sure that you get legal advice and have an attorney for a full patent filing that actually pulls those claims out, because that it's the claims that really the legal battles go over is what are you claiming in this patent? What are you claiming as innovative and new and unique? And so those are the things where when you get into legal battles, that's where they're going to be looking at is your claims. So that's where you definitely want some legal advice. And then when you apply it for a patent, I would suggest using legal help for the reasons I just said. You can ask the question, are we only going to do a provisional at this point? Are we going to do a full filing? There's also a question there on provisional versus full filing based upon how long do we expect to go to market? If we expect to be in the market for 2 years, 3 years, four tops, then it may not be worth going through the full patent process. Why? Well, because it's going to take you that long, maybe 2 to 5 years to get a patent. And if your product then is over and done with and you've sold all the widgets you're going to sell, it's not worth it for you. So that's where a provisional or the illusion of control of where you can still say patent pending matters. Are you going to go just USPTO, which means you're just going to be domestic in the United States, or are you going worldwide where you need to deal with the WIPO and do a PCT filing? So, or are you going to defer applying for a patent because it's just smarter not to? So, and those are business decisions. And that's a little bit different advice than what an attorney would give you. Okay, so that's it for that video. The next time I'm going to talk is a little bit more about IP decision making, depending upon what you're doing. Thank you.